In this episode of the On.NET Show, we're going to have some folks join us from the Azure SDK team to show us how we can make use of these new SDKs they're building to leverage Azure services inside of our apps. Check it out. Hey everyone, welcome to another episode of the On.NET Show. And today I have some special guests for me from the Azure SDK team. So why don't we start off with you folks just introducing yourselves and let me know what exactly it is that you do on the team.
I'm Adrian. I'm a program manager for the SDK team dealing with architecture.
I'm Alex. I'm an engineering manager on the .NET side of the SDK for Azure.
Gotcha. And so your team specifically not only just does .NET SDKs, but your team is responsible for all the Azure SDKs. So we're talking about .NET, we're talking about Python, Java, JavaScript, like all of those things are underneath that umbrella, right?
Yeah, pretty much every single language, if it's got an Azure SDK, it will fall into our group eventually. But right now, you're right, those four languages are what our focus is.
Gotcha, okay. So we've had SDKs for Azure for a long time, right? But I'm sure you guys are here to talk about some new SDKs. So why don't we talk about, firstly, one, why the need to create these new SDKs, right? Because I'm kind of wondering, like, what's wrong with the old ones?
So we went out to a lot of customers, and we talked to them about the problems that they were having, the issues, and how we could improve. And we came up with certain things that were fairly universal across them. Firstly, there wasn't a one-to-one relationship between what the service offered and the individual languages. Okay. So a feature might be available in .NET, but not in Python, for example. So we wanted to unify the experience so that it didn't matter which language you wrote in, you would get the same experience. The second thing was that there were a lot of niggling issues. In the .NET world, for example, dependency management. One SDK would use JSON.NET of one version, and a different service SDK would use a different version. And reconciling that was problematic for people.
Got it.
So those were the biggest reasons why we did this. And what we did was we came up with a plan to produce a unified Azure SDK so that if you used a service SDK, a service client library, as we call them now, from this unified Azure SDK, you would get the same experience across all the services that were in that set.
Gotcha. And you know what I really love about that is, you know, in modern day software development, what I always find from our customers is there's never usually just one programming language in a solution, right, or in a company. Right. I've worked with folks that have been using, you know, Ruby and Python together, or using PHP and C# together, or, you know, .NET and Python together. Yep. Right. And we always want to find a way that we could, you know, have that common knowledge shared back and forth between the two. So it kind of sounds to me like, you know, if I'm a Python guy or if I'm a Java guy, right, and I have the knowledge of the SDKs, I can assume that like very similar patterns would exist between these different SDKs. So the time that it takes me to ramp up to be productive would be a little bit less, right?
Yeah, I mean, even across services, there's certain things that you do regularly,
sure.
You know, like paging, for example.
Yeah.
And you shouldn't have to learn a new paradigm every single time you go to a new service just for what is in essence a list operation.
Gotcha. Sure, that makes sense. So I know earlier we were talking about a couple pillars of areas of focus for these SDKs, mm-hmm. right? Like, could we talk about those a little bit? Could you touch on those?
Yeah,
really quickly?
Absolutely. Our we've actually got a set of guidelines. There's a set of general guidelines that we use to develop per language guidelines.
Yeah.
And then we've got guidelines for every single language that kind of translate those general guidelines into the language of choice to make sure that it's idiomatic.
Got it.
.NET, of course, has a very strong idiomatic sense of what it takes to produce a good library.
Sure.
Aside from the idiomatic usage, we have approachable as a big pillar. And that really means that as a developer, you should be able to get started and you should be able to understand the concepts from the service relatively easily. So that really translates into a great documentation experience, starting from the quick start that you use to learn how to integrate the library, all the way through to how do I do this thing that I'm doing in the code.
Yeah.
And to be able to translate the concepts from one library to another. So the paging one is the one I always come up to, but
sure.
You know, streaming data or how do you do error handling. how do you do logging? Those should be common concepts across the library.
And that makes sense too, because again, as a developer, like these are things that I have to write over and over and over again. So it's really good to hear like the framework and the libraries just have this kind of like built in, right? So I could leverage the work and also to have that consistency across like these different SDKs that you're building.
Yeah. So the second pillar is dependability. Mm-hmm. And this really comes down to one core tenet that we have. We are doing the final breaking change to end all breaking changes.
Okay.
And we are committing to no breaking changes from this point on.
Oh, that's a big one.
When you're using the unified Azure SDK, mm-hmm. you can write it with one library, you can upgrade the library for all of the security updates and keep up to date,
yeah.
and we won't break you.
Awesome.
So that's a really, and when you think about how important that is for people to actually get those security updates, just by a recompile of their program,
sure.
That becomes a seriously big effort.
Right. That's awesome. I know, again, for a lot of folks that think about like just keeping up to date and upgrading and those types of things, it becomes a process, right? Because now I got to put this through my CI/CD environment. I got to have QA look at it, and I got to make sure that I can verify the software before we put it out to our different customers.
Right.
And so just the fact that we can have that reassurance that, oh my God, like, I don't know what these Microsoft folks are gonna do. They gotta change some stuff and, all hell's gonna break loose.
Yeah.
Right? So just knowing that we have that consistency is extremely important.
Yeah, we've all been there when the new library has broken us and we've just died on the vine.
Gotcha. I know there were some other things that we wanted to talk about too, like for instance, like the consistency and also like the ability to diagnose some of these things too, right? Like were those core tenets of what we, what you talked about whenever you built this library?
Yeah, absolutely. Like one of the, as Adrian mentioned, one of the first things we did is we developed the sort of guidelines that we wanted to follow. And those guidelines were going to help people understand our product and be able to use it across in a consistent way.
Sure.
And we also wanted to take some of those guidelines and codify it in a way that our developers can build SDKs and configure them in a way. And to do that, we've created this core library we call Azure.core that maintains implement some of those guidelines in code. Things like retry, logging, distributed sure. tracing are all coded in that library, and we could use. And it is the library that makes the communication between the other code and the service code, and handles all the heavy lifting for the SDK. Another thing that we heard from customers that is very, like, as a pain point is authentication. Setting up your authentication is a very not trivial thing to do.
Sure.
And we took this opportunity to create a library called Azure Identity that has abstracting that away from our customers and makes the customers use the SDK without having to think too much about authentication. And we have talks going into more details for both Azure Core and Azure Identity
sure.
Coming up. So another thing that we wanted to do is in the same line of consistency, we have all the packages that we have, as Adrian said, we're coming up with new packages. We want to make them in a consistent way, so all the packages will have the same prefix. They all will start with Azure dot, and you can go and search it on your on NuGet or your other package manager, and they all look the same, and it's easy to find.
Sure. And you had a slide about that too, right? Didn't you?
Yeah.
That you wanted to show us really quickly.
Sure. So this is the this is our slide where you can find our guidelines are. All open source, we're all in open source, everything sure. is on GitHub. We have design guidelines where you can go and read about how we've designed and produced our packages. You can find NuGet packages on NuGet.org, which is the default NuGet package manager for .NET.
Sure.
Our source code and docs are all available in the open as well. And I have a demo that I'm gonna show later, and you'll be able to look at the source code for that as well.
Sure, that sounds great.
So I wanted, jump back to my the coding part of this thing, where I wanted to show how some of these guidelines can transfer directly into the code, and how we can make it so much easier for customers to use these libraries. So I'm going to show you a small ASP.NET Core app that we wrote that is basically a cloud clipboard. You can type some code in some text in here. And then you say you save it, and then it will have a list of clips that you can share with your friends and do all that. And so
okay.
let me jump into the code and show you how this was all put together.
Yeah, that sounds great.
So if we look at the I'm going to contrast the before and after, how we used to have to do this before our libraries come in and how you could do it later. So if you look at the setup of this library is, you know, it's an MVC application, and you have to figure out how am I going to make my service client available inside the other inside the application to be used in the code. And so in order to do that, you had to create an Azure service token provider, retrieve a token from that, create a token credential using that, pass that to a storage credential, finally create a cloud blob client, and then add that as a singleton in your application. That's how the code that you had to do and write for your application to authenticate with Azure and retrieve all the information. With the new version of our libraries, what you can do that line that now that becomes a single line of code, and that what it does is it says, you know, please add a Azure Server client, and this is the add a blob service client and configure it with this service URI. And in the background, what we do is we use the default Azure credential object that's part of Azure Identity to discover the right set of credentials for you to use. So you'll be able to write this code once, and you'll be able to run it in your local dev box as well as in production without making any changes to this. And the code behind Azure Identity will take care of figuring out the credentials from the environment that you're in.
Gotcha. So what you're showing us right now on the screen is at the top, when we're looking at, you know, V11, that is the current or the currently released version of the SDKs that are available today that people are using already. And then what we're looking at now at line 46 is, well, the new hotness, right? Like the easier mode that we're enabling with these new set of SDKs that I believe are in preview today.
Yes.
Gotcha. Okay.
So and then if we you know, and as we talked about, another consistency part that we wanted to address is making sure that the code that you write is taking advantage of the right set of or the later set of features that are available in your language to make you more productive and make you write less code.
Sure.
So as Adrian mentioned, you know, iterating and paging over a set of items is a pretty complex task. And so, as you saw in the beginning of the demo, I was listing out the blobs that are available in the on the storage in the container. And so the code that I had to write in the V11 of it was, you know, it was this code, you know, get the service, find the container that can for that particular user, mm-hmm. And have two nested loops, one that iterates over the pages and one that iterates over the items in the page. And so this is a non-trivial amount of code, and you know, it's easy to get wrong.
Sure.
And so taking advantage of the async iterators in the C#, in the new language feature in C#, we can collapse those lines to this particular, like to these few lines where you call get blob container client, you retrieve the user container, and then you iterate in an asynchronous fashion over the items and you return them.
Got it.
And this, you know, is available across all of our libraries that support paging, and it's again part of our consistency model for how we get, you know, the same features and same behaviors in the product.
Got it. And so I'm guessing these libraries are targeting a certain version of .NET standard. So are these .NET standards 2.0
yes.
libraries?
Yes, all? There.
Got it.
And so one of the other things that I'd like to mention, two more things. One is all of this code is using our Azure core library as a core library, and that library will handle retries and a bunch of other, you know, heavy lifting underneath it.
Sure.
And it also does the distributed tracing efforts. So when you're looking at your application, you make a call to a service, that service might make additional calls in the background. And with the distributed tracing, you can get a feel for did my call actually end up making? What calls did it end up making? And you know, if we look at a simple example, this is how you would look at your application. This is a request for the blobs that we just saw.
Yeah.
And you could drill in as a customer, as a developer, you can drill into and understand or figure out where, you know, what is taking so long. You have information here to come up with some sort of a, you know, who called what and what responses that I got, how long it took, and I can further diagnose my my library or my application.
Gotcha. So what you're showing us right now on the screen is Azure Monitor, right? Like,
yes.
Again, one of the services that we have inside of Azure today. Is there anything special that I have to do to wire up inside of my SDK or inside of my code for us to collect this, or does this just happen automatically?
I think it
pretty much happens automatically. Yeah. You do have to wire up the standard Azure Monitor exporter.
Okay.
The distributed tracing is based on OpenTelemetry,
okay.
Which is an open standard now. Mm. And the way that works is you emit in your library or your application, you emit spans, which say this is where this operation started, this is where it ends, and you get this hierarchy of spans, and they just get emitted to the OpenTelemetry system.
Got it.
And then there's an exporter that says, export the data that I'm receiving to my store of choice. So it doesn't have to be Azure Monitor, it could be whatever you choose to do, and Azure Monitor supports OpenTelemetry.
Okay, that's awesome. Because I know, you know, in terms of ASP.NET applications, I'm pretty familiar with using something like Application Insights, and then I'd have like a instrumentation key, and now it instruments my code, you know, whether it's my page views or my service calls, my dependencies, and these types of things. Right, so you're saying now with this, I don't really have to do a lot of that stuff. Like, it'll just automatically happen for me? Or would I still have to give it, like,
to give it a key to do the exporter to the right place.
Got it. Okay, that makes sense.
But all of this is wired in through all our, across our SDKs, and you can even user code can participate in the same spans that can get exported to Azure Monitor.
Okay, that sounds pretty good. So really quickly, just to summarize, so we spoke about, you know, there's some new SDKs that are coming. Right, we spoke about some of the reasons why that, you know, we've created these new SDKs. We've seen some really cool and interesting demos too, just really quickly about how these things might work. One thing I might want to know about is, you know, Azure has tons of different services in there. Are we doing new SDKs for all of these services, or do we have like a core set that we're trying to focus on right now?
We have a core set that we're trying to focus on right now. They are storage, event hubs, the new app configuration service.
Cosmos.
Cosmos is important.
Cosmos is important, yes.
Key Vault.
And we'll be expanding that list over time.
Gotcha, sounds great. Awesome. Well, hey, thank you all for coming on the show. I really appreciate it. And I think what we'll do is we'll make sure that, you know, all these resources and any, you know, blog posts or to-dos or GitHub repos, we'll make sure we add them to the show notes so everybody can check them out.
Thanks a lot.
Great, awesome. And thank you all for watching. This has been another episode of the On.NET Show. We've learned how we could take advantage of these new Azure SDKs for .NET that this team is building for us.